by the decisions of those much more powerful than them. That is why I go there, to get the story firsthand.
Some call me nature. Others call me Mother Nature. I've been here for over 4.5 billion years. 22,500 times longer than you. I don't really need people, but people need me. I have fed species greater than you, and I have starved species greater than you. How you choose to live each day doesn't really matter to me. I am nature. I will go on. I am prepared to evolve. Are you?
Pictures from Ferguson, Missouri this morning. Actually, this is Delwood, the town right next door, but you can see firefighters still battling the blazes there. Law enforcement said there were 12 buildings set on fire. We've seen estimates well north of that, maybe 20, 25 buildings damaged by fire, and you can see, again, the efforts to tamp down these fires still going on. Demonstrators set these buildings on fire. Also, police cars following the grand jury decision to clear police officer Darren Wilson of the shooting death of Michael Brown. CNN cameras captured protesters breaking storefront windows. You can see it right there. Then going in and clearing out the shelves, looting. As police in riot gear lobbed smoke bombs and tear gas at them in other instances to keep them from advancing on the precinct house. Prosecutors released evidence from the grand jury proceedings, including Officer Darren Wilson's testimony. Very unusual that an officer would testify in this situation. He says he hoped just to arrest Brown, but he claims the teenager punched him twice and charged him, insisting that Brown kept on, this is a quote from Darren Wilson, running through the shots as he kept on firing.
And the streets of Ferguson turned dangerous very, very quickly once the grand jury decision was announced. CNN correspondents were on the ground. They got caught up in all the demonstrations and the chaos. Take a look at these tense moments for our Chris Cuomo and Don Lemon.
The police officers are taking her. Tear gas.
Tear gas.
This tear gas just dropped right near us. It's going to get very bad here if we don't have masks.
Yeah, so
they're throwing it back. There are a lot of beanbags being shown at tear gas. We'll go to Susan Hendricks right now so we can clear the scene.
And Chris Cuomo and Don Lemon found themselves engulfed in that tear gas when police began lobbing the canisters in their direction, where a lot of protesters were gathered. At first, officers said that they did not use tear gas, claiming that they were just smoke bombs, but then they quickly backed off those claims.
All right, stay with CNN. We're going to continue our breaking coverage of the chaos in and around Ferguson. We're also going to look at some of the other protests that have been bubbling up around the country. Stay with us.
call me nature. Others call me Mother Nature. I've been here for over 4.5 billion years. 22,500 times longer than you. I don't really need people, but people need me. I have fed species greater than you, and I have starved species greater than you. How you choose to live each day doesn't really matter to me. I am nature. I will go on. I am prepared to evolve. Are you?
What happens when simple innovations are used to improve women's and children's health? Lives are saved. Healthy communities grow. Economies develop. Find out how you can join others and help save lives.
This is CNN.
Over the years, I've had the privilege and the opportunity not just to anchor, but also report on the news, and I still do it. Hala Gharani, CNN. And therefore, I take everything I learn in the field to the studio. And it's important. You can't just do one thing or the other. You really have to have that global perspective, but also that ground level perspective.
This is just a completely surreal experience.
When you speak to a newsmaker on a satellite feed, that has value. Sure it does. But if you speak to the 14-year-old refugee girl who can barely afford her school books, that has just as much value. And that's what's important about this program. We bring you the news through the eyes, through the opinions, through the vantage points of everyone who's a part of the story. That is the world right now.
The World Right Now with Hala Gharani, today on CNN.
I'm Will Ripley in Tokyo, and this is CNN.
Breaking overnight, looting and chaos on the streets of Ferguson, Missouri. Demonstrators torching buildings and police cars following a grand jury's decision not to indict police officer Darren Wilson on any of the five possible charges he was facing in the shooting death of Michael Brown. CNN cameras captured protesters breaking storefronts using what appeared to be bats and clearing out shelves. Police in riot gear lobbed smoke bombs and tear gas to disperse them and keep them from advancing to the precinct station house. Prosecutors also releasing evidence from the grand jury proceedings. They include Officer Wilson's testimony. He says that he wanted to just arrest Michael Brown, told him even to back away and get on the ground, but says the teenager kept coming at him, punching him repeatedly in the face, charging at him when he finally got out of the car, and insisting that Brown kept, quote, running through the shots as the officer kept on firing.
Protesters angry about the grand jury decision in Ferguson.
Season's greetings from CNC3.
This Time Check is brought to you by Sunshine Granola Crunch Sachets. Sunshine Cereals, wake up to a better breakfast every day.
Good morning, Trinidad and Tobago. I'm here with Ramki Soon, and this is the Morning Brew. How are you today? It is a beautiful Tuesday morning, and this morning, as is customary, we're going to continue to follow all of the major stories affecting life in Trinidad and Tobago. But before we get into our first interview this morning, let's remind you why you should buy the Trinidad and Tobago Guardian. The front page of the Guardian newspaper, well, $100,000 reward offered for any information relating to the killing of the German couple in Tobago there, and that occurred last week. The community is still coming to terms with what is taking place. The tourism minister, the THA, and the police officers all in a united front yesterday condemning the act of violence. Is it enough, and will more be done to secure not only tourists but the island of Tobago? So we're going to look at that. Also, I know that Akash Samra will have some breaking news this morning as it relates to some information coming out of the PNM's camp. So we're going to continue to follow that story. And the biggest news coming out of the U.S. this morning, and we're going to touch on that, the verdict in the Ferguson shooting. And there you see some footage there. But we're going to check in with Akash Samra. We'll talk more about that when we come back.
Good morning, I'm Akash Samaru, and this is your 6 a.m. news here on CNC3 and the TBC Radio Network. Acting Police Commissioner Stephen Williams says he has put together a strong, experienced team of officers to solve the murder of a German couple in Tobago on Saturday. He made the announcement after a meeting with THA Chief Secretary Orville London and THA officials yesterday. It comes as the island braces for a backlash on its main economy, tourism.
It's a matter which is receiving the highest level of policing attention. I have assigned the assistant commissioner with responsibility for homicide investigations in Trinidad and Tobago to lead this investigation in Tobago.
Meanwhile, police are continuing to question Asmon Alexander, who was captured on Sunday in Malabar. 28-year-old Alexander, who has been described as the country's most wanted man, was held by officers after being on the run for the last 10 months. Senior Superintendent David Abraham of the Northern Division says Alexander is being interviewed by homicide officers in connection with the Brasso Seco murders and kidnapping of a family. The senior superintendent adds Alexander is also being questioned to see what information he can provide in connection with several other offenses, including shooting and bribery. Alexander escaped custody from the Mayaro Magistrates Court in January. His attorney, Farid Ali, says he is concerned about his client's state of mind.
I can't go into the details of the conversation. That is indeed a privileged conversation. What I can say is my concern with regard to Mr. Alexander at this stage is him having been sought after by the police for an extended period of time. And I'm concerned about his state of mind at this time in terms of his collectivity and his whole demeanor.
Meanwhile, over 20 officers, including a senior superintendent, Abraham, are expected to receive commendation awards from Acting Commissioner of Police Stephen Williams sometime soon for capturing Alexander and for the rescue of sisters Janelle and Felicia Gonzalez, who were kidnapped in Brasso Seco. Well, days before the one-year anniversary of her death, the Kiana Kamabach murder inquiry has begun. Yesterday, the six-year-old's mother, Simone Williams, stood in the same courtroom with the man accused of the crime, Dwayne Lewis. He sat quietly in the prisoner's dock, barely flinching, meters away. In the public gallery stood Simone Williams, Kiana's mother. She was accompanied by her father and stepsister. On a few occasions, Dwayne stole a glance at Simone, but eye contact barely materialized. After a delay to deal with procedural matters and a lunch break for the accused, the inquiry began with the draftsman in the investigation, Sergeant Gregory Hood. Following Mr. Hood was Officer Michael Stanley, the police photographer who went to the Maloney Gardens crime scene on November 26th and 28th. However, Kiana's mother was unable to take the stand because of time constraints. The matter was adjourned to December 2nd at 1 p.m. And that was your 6 a.m. news here on CNC3 and the TBC Radio Network. The Morning Brew with Himaram Kisun is up next.
What does 300 milliliters of pure energy look like? We experimented with our old bottle. We made it slimmer. We used plastic instead of glass, so it's lighter. And it still holds the same 300 milliliters of liquid energy that everyone loves. In a great new slimmer, sleeker, lighter bottle. An easier way to hold the same amount of energy. Now that is a yes moment. Lucozade Energy. Better bottle, same amount.
Hi, I'm Shivana. When I heard the news from my school teacher, I was shocked beyond words. None of this would have been possible without God, my parents and family, all my hardworking teachers, and of course at the Guardian STA practice tests. I used that every Wednesday since I was in Standard 4 and made sure I checked the results on the Friday. Parents, I would encourage you strongly to get the Guardian STA every Wednesday for your child and help them achieve their true potential.
The SEA practice test, free in your Wednesday Guardian.
What is the most difficult thing about being on a strict diet? The hunger, right? Finally, there's an effective way to overcome the hunger. Metabolic Reset Weight Loss Shakes. Metabolic Reset is a delicious drink that's uniquely designed to reduce the hunger and help you feel more satisfied with smaller portions of food. So you always lose weight and keep it off because of sticking to your diet with Metabolic Reset. It's distributed by H&J Enterprises.
Suffering from back and spinal problems and don't know what's causing it? Get a spinal scan done at the Spinal Institute of Trinidad and Tobago. Computerized spinal examinations can now be done via a surface electromyograph or SEMG scan. This scan would show the specific areas and degree of subluxation and the direction of imbalance in the vertebral column. These specific readings make treatment more accurate and effective. Call today at 665-5433. The Spinal Institute of Trinidad and Tobago, taking care of your spinal needs.
Seaview Optical announces their 2015 Michael Kors and Coach promotions. With the purchase of all Michael Kors and Coach frames, get 25% off plus 50% off all Michael Kors and Coach sunglasses. Complete single vision lenses with frames at $299. Bifocal lenses with frame, $479. Latest on all Cruzal Sapphire, Provencia and Avance lenses. Seaview Optical, affordable eye care for everyone.
Footloose, a new era in fashion. Step into our stores at High Street San Fernando and be dazzled by our excellent customer service with fashion that suits all. Turn your wishes into reality. Footloose, where quality and price pleases every pocket.
Tobago, get ready! November 28th, Island Mix brings to you the hottest Juve band launch to hit Pigeon Point. See acts like Roy K featuring Blacks, Patrice Roberts, Banjai, Olatunji, Talpuri, Fata Fox, Fire Empress, and RDX. Purchase tickets at all Penny Savers, Jade Monkey, Barcode, Pablo Supermarket, Highland Grocery Mart, Viewpoint Supermarkets, and Pumpy Barbershop. General admission $300 and VIP $600. Plus, prize for the biggest crew. Check us on Facebook at Island Mix Promotions. Island Mix, we start the carnival.
Health Mobility Specialists Limited is the distributor of Bruno Independent Living Aids, manufacturer of products designed to enhance the lives of those challenged by limited mobility. Our indoor or outdoor stair lifts, or perhaps an interior or exterior residential vertical platform lift, will have you exploring your surroundings. Call us today.
The Morning Brew is brought to you in part by Wendy's.
I'm Ramki Tune, and this is The Morning Brew. Welcome again. This morning, we're going to continue to follow all of the major stories affecting life in Trinidad and Tobago. Don't forget, you can follow us on Twitter at CNC3TV, hashtag TMB, or at @him_RamkiSoon, hashtag TMB. Akash is also on Twitter at Akash Samru, and you can follow our hardworking producer at Carissa_Lee to get the very latest coming out of The Morning Brew. Don't forget, if you want to send us an email during the show, it's tmb@cnc3.co.tt. And we are streaming live, www.cnc3.co.tt. And you can catch excerpts of our show on radio frequency 7:30 a.m. So we're making sure that you are continually connected. Now, this morning, we're going to be dealing with gender-based violence. Margaret Sampson-Brown and Dr. Diane Douglas joins us on set this morning. They both join us on set. Also, the situation, we're going to monitor what's happening internationally. And I know Akash will have some news coming out of the PNM camp this morning. Some interesting news that Patrick Manning may actually be still throwing his hat into the 2015 race. So we are going to continue to follow these stories and so much more. But before we take our first break and before we begin our first interview, let's give you something to think about while you share a morning cup of coffee with us. Thousands of candles can be lit from a single candle, and the life of that candle will not be shortened. Happiness never decreases by being shared. Sometimes we have to remember to just be happy and share the happiness that's around, and share it with those around us sometimes. So people around us sometimes need a little nudge, or a little more than a nudge. So push and share happiness all around you. We take a very short break. When we come back, we're going to be sharing with you some excerpts from CNN as it relates to what's taking place in Ferguson, Missouri. In case you didn't know, last night the grand jury, well, they basically found the police officer not guilty of any charges. The family of Michael Brown, they released a statement a short while ago saying that they are disappointed that the killer of their child will not face the consequences of his actions. We take a very short break. When we come back, we're going to get an attorney at law to just give us an idea of exactly what took place in this trial that has dominated the headlines. And since the shooting, the police shooting and police killing of that 18-year-old boy, the town of Ferguson, Missouri, it has been described as the next birthplace of the civil rights movements, or the next era of the civil rights movements, as we look at race relations in the USA. Stay with us. This is The Morning Brew.
Homeland Furnishings, your trendsetters for unique, one-of-a-kind items, large variety, exclusive quality furniture. View our new amazing range of outdoor furnishings, everything to make your home sparkle and your neighbor jealous this Christmas. Beautiful beds and comforter sets, classy and interesting vases, plus fabric land, storage land, kids land, rugs and more. Homeland Furnishings, Piarco Plaza, where being unique doesn't cost a lot. Open on Sundays.
Get it at Home Express and outfit your home with the best brands at the best prices. Home Express, where no one does it better.
It's Meat Melt Wednesdays at Ruby Tuesday. Buy one ribs or burger entree and get 50% off a second entree of equal or lesser value. Meat Melt Wednesdays gives you satisfaction guaranteed on every level. Rich, bold flavors to savor at great value and an all-round fun time. Check out Meat Melt Wednesdays from 5 to 11 p.m. at Ruby Tuesday. Ruby Tuesday, it's all good here.
Sometimes the protection that is available is not what you need. Support can be forthcoming in abundance, but it just does not fit. Your specific needs seem not to be important, and as a result, neither is your shot at success. Don't settle for just any support and protection. What you need is FlexiCover from Furness Anchorage General Insurance. We will design a coverage package that will suit your workmen's compensation, public liability, contractors all risk, and performance bonds needs. Contact your broker or Furness Anchorage General Insurance today and get FlexiCover. Furness Anchorage, a symbol of quality and trust.
Varma Steel's annual Christmas sale is now on. Get reduced prices on Varma's high-grade roofing sheets, flashing, guttering, Z-purlings, decking sheets, steel beams, and VRC. Varma's high-grade roofing sheets with a life of 40 to 50 years will not get moss, fade, peel, nor rust like low-grade PVF and other low-grade sheets. Visit Varma Steel in Pleasance Park next to the St. Margaret's Police Station or call 659-4008. Varma Steel, for the best in quality at the lowest prices.
Add magic to your home this Christmas. Atlantic Trading Company and Magic Mist brings a magical theme competition to you. All you have to do is purchase three or more powerhouse products, fill out your entry form, attach bill, and drop in the powerhouse box. The winner then receives a day with the Magic Mist team cleaning your entire home professionally. Enter the magical clean competition with powerhouse cleaning products today. Distributed by Atlantic Trading Company Limited. Competition approved by NLCB. It's Santa's big super Christmas sale in November. We want you to remember. Up to 60% off in our new basement sale. Lots of perfumes, gifts, ornaments, Christmas decorations, flowers, hair, nails, and costume jewelry, handbags, scarves, and more. Some items buy one and pay half price for a second item. So come and get the best for less. 70 to 72 High Street, San Fernando, and 8 to 10 Point de Pere Road, San Fernando. Remember, at Santa's, our duty is to care for your beauty. Tile Expression, the number one leader in tiles. Christmas tile sale. 12 by 12, $3.95. 17 by 17, $7.50. 18 by 18, $8.50. Porcelain, 24 by 24, $27.95. Micro milling tin set, $37.95. Tile Expression, Monroe Road, Canupia, near the mosque.
Japan Motors off Monroe Road, Charleville for quality imported roll-on roll-off cars. Subaru Impreza, Honda CR-V, Mazda 3, the new Hilux Vigo, Nissan Navara, and Ford Wildtrak. 3 years warranty and accessories. Call 672-3000 or 672-6266.
Welcome back, Trinidad and Tobago. Well, joining us on the telephone, we're going to be speaking with attorney at law Wayne Stage. And the reason, if you are following the international news, President Barack Obama addressing the nation this morning, calling on the population of the U.S. First and foremost, we are a nation built on the rule of law, asking citizens to accept the judge's decision or the grand jury's decision in the Ferguson case. And this is the case with the police officer killing 18-year-old Michael Brown. President Obama saying, I join Michael's parents and asking anyone who protests this decision to do so peacefully. Our police have been out in their numbers in the town of Ferguson, Missouri since the grand jury came to its decision last night. Looting protests, violent protests. I think over 30 persons have been arrested. Persons are also marching on the White House this morning. A very volatile situation as we look at race relations and what's coming out of the judicial system in the U.S. And is this the same situation as the Trayvon Martin case? Now, joining us on the telephone, we have attorney at law Wayne Sturge. Mr. Sturge, good morning. Thank you for joining us. My first question to you would obviously be, what exactly does that verdict mean? Is it that the police officer will now walk free of any charges? And in a case that is so charged in the public domain, a lot of emotions, people were actually expecting this officer to face the full brunt of the law.
Well, it does mean that the police officer would walk free. But you have to understand that the public, by virtue of what was put out in the media, would have had the version given by the friends of the accused. Mm-hmm. Not much airplay was given to the version given by the police officer. Mm-hmm. And in the end, the grand jury would have had to come to a verdict based on the evidence, which would have which would have also contained the scientific version, the DNA, and so on. As I understand it, some time ago, when the results came back from the forensic center, it became obvious what the verdict would be. So yesterday was basically expected.
Now, you know, I have to ask you that because I know we've had this discussion also because we've analyzed the Trayvon Martin case and we saw the uproar following that. There, thousands of persons are marching throughout the town of Ferguson this morning. Obviously, you also have protests taking place in Washington, D.C. President Barack Obama addressing the nation a short while ago, calling for peace. The role of the media and also balancing the facts and getting the story right, getting it all into play. What do you think we can actually learn from this? And I have to also ask in the context of race relations.
Well, in the context of race relations, you have to understand the racial dynamic of that particular...
Because we're talking about Ferguson, Missouri, which is in the south of the U.S., basically.
Yes, you have to understand the dynamics there. Now, what may have incensed the population... And we don't know for certain what the composition of the grand jury would be. Mm-hmm. If it's an all-white grand jury, regardless of how correct the verdict is, that would incense most persons, because most persons may not have had sight of the evidence placed before the grand jury. So even if they were correct in law, a lot of the times. It's just like the Rodney King verdict years ago. Of course, Rodney King was overturned. That was wrong.
Right.
But the whole point is, if you have an all-white grand jury returning a verdict, no matter if it is correct in law, the perception is that it must have been influenced by race. But you have to understand, I think it was a few, probably 8 weeks ago, when the findings came back, the forensic findings, that Michael Brown's DNA's blood was on the officer's door. It meant that, contrary to the version given by the media,
mm-hmm.
pushed by the media. Of course, it's not the media who made it up, but they were giving a lot of currency to the
right.
version given by the friends and so on. And the version given was inconsistent with the findings of the forensic scientists.
Now,
so,
you know, my final question to you, Mr. Sturgeon, I have to ask this because you are operating in the judicial system. We're seeing violent protests erupting throughout the streets of Ferguson, and we're showing the footage coming out of CNN now this morning. And this is coming out of a police killing. We have had situations where protests have erupted following what residents describe as the use of blunt force. What do you really think? Can we draw parallels to our own local situation as a result of what's taking place in the U.S.?
Well, I think the Americans are being taught a lesson now, mm-hmm. and the responsibility of the media comes into view. If the media is fueling one aspect of it and they're on the race issue, then when the verdict comes back and it's not in your favor, and most people don't have access to the material placed before the grand jury, then what do you expect? We don't have that kind of media currency in Trinidad before trial. Even when Brad Boyce was acquitted,
mm-hmm.
There was no protest and so on and so on. And that is in large part because trials in Trinidad and Tobago are sanitized. And secondly,
right.
when something gets before the court, it's sub judice, and you don't have all this kind of media coverage. In the United States, it's trial by media.
Yeah.
So when the verdict eventually comes out with the real evidence, and you get a verdict that the public does not expect because the media fed something different,
mm.
then you have to expect that sort of reaction. But in Trinidad and Tobago, it doesn't mean we are not as violent as they are.
Okay.
It simply means we are not exposed to trial by media.
Mr. Stitch, thanks so much for joining us to clarify. Mr. Stitch saying that he's not surprised by the verdict delivered last night. If you were looking, that is footage coming out of the U.S. violent protests erupting in the town of Ferguson, Missouri. Protesters marching on the White House this morning. President Barack Obama addressing the nation. He says that we need to recognize that the situation in Ferguson speaks to broader challenges that we face as a nation. That's the USA. The fact is that too many parts of the country, there's a deep distrust that exists between law enforcement and communities of color. Some of this is a result of the legacy of racial discrimination in this country, and this is a tragic because nobody needs good policing more than poor communities with higher crime rates. So you're looking at the socioeconomic dynamic as well as the race composition, and you must also remember that Missouri and the legacy of the southern communities in the U.S. of A. So it's going to be an interesting thing to follow, but President Barack Obama and even the parents of Michael Brown calling on the protesters to stop the violent protests. We take a very short break. When we come back, we're going to talk about violence, gender-based violence. Stay with us.
Fire up your day with the new spicy sriracha chicken at Subway restaurants. We're talking tender, juicy strips of 100% chicken breast with our signature sriracha sauce for our boldest flavor yet. Then make it yours by choosing your favorite bread and topping it high with lots of fresh veggies and melted cheese. Mmm, yes, sriracha. Embrace your bold side with the new spicy sriracha chicken at Subway restaurants. Subway. Eat fresh.
Attention all caterers, wholesalers, and retailers. Beaver Distributors Limited introduces our brand new styrofoam products. Low prices on our superior brand personal care items, cleaning products, paper products, and our wholesale sizes of food items. Come in today at Beaver Distributors Limited. Superior quality at superior low prices.
Imagine you can scroll through, see, enlarge, and select your food, all in the palm of your hand. Introducing Menu Tablets, all part of the award-winning first-class service experience at Touch and Taste. Say goodbye to old-fashioned printed menus, and say hello to the future of fine dining. Touch and Taste. Visit us today at number 8 West Boundary Street, California, Point Lisas, Trinidad, or call 636-1912. Touch and Taste. Prepare to be satisfied.
CV Optical announces their 2015 Michael Kors and Coach promotions. With the purchase of all Michael Kors and Coach frames, get 25% off plus 50% off all Michael Kors and Coach sunglasses. Complete single vision lenses with frames at $299. Bifocal lenses with frame, $479. Latest on all Cruzal Sapphire, Provencia and Avance lenses. CV Optical, affordable eye care for everyone.
Is death to the flies, death to the roaches, death to the mosquitoes, death to the spider, death to the ants, death to flea on your clothes, death to the weevil and maribonta, death is really dread, death to the sandfly, death to campania, death to bugs in your bed. Now is the time to clean up the mess. Is death to all insect pests.
Death is now available in 3 formulations, citronella, lemon and original.
Death kill them dead!
Footloose, a new era in fashion. Step into our stores at High Street San Fernando and be dazzled by our excellent customer service with fashion that suits all. Turn your wishes into reality. Footloose, where quality and price pleases every pocket.
Green Dot Limited, wireless, digital, cable and internet masters. No phone lines necessary. Quick and easy installation. Unlimited internet access. Call 623-4643 and be part of the Green Dot today.
Legacy and stability. I'm sure you would agree that these words ring true for those who want to invest in a secure future for their children or even in retirement and desire to yield high returns. At TBLA, we can provide you with prudent investment instruments. So if you're looking for that future you longed for, then visit us at TBLA and find out which investment product is right for you. TBLA, a secure home to invest.
Shop early at UP's chain of fabric stores for the best selection of fashion and home decor fabrics. Your Christmas decorating is easy with the widest selection of curtain panels, comforters, sheet sets, mirrors, and framed art. UP's, for fabrics and home decor.
Par Excellence is the number one housewife's choice in Trinidad and Tobago and is now introducing a new range of products. White rice, parboiled rice, white sugar, brown sugar, and much more. Available at leading supermarkets nationwide.
We're coming on. Welcome back, Trinidad and Tobago. Joining us on set now, Dr. Diane Douglas, a psychologist and also associated with Douglas and Associates, and Margaret Sampson Brown, the head of the Victim Support Unit of Trinidad and Tobago. And we're talking gender-based violence, 16 days of activism ending violence against women. So today we're recognizing internationally, let's end violence against women. And this is all part of 16 days of activism against gender-based violence. It's an international campaign that starts officially today. Good morning, ladies. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Now, let me start with you, Dr. Douglas. A day, 16 days of recognizing the need to end gender-based violence. Mm-hmm. How prevalent is gender-based violence in a society like ours?
Oh, my goodness. Very prevalent, Hema, very prevalent. We see it just recently with an entire family, mm-hmm. an entire family, mostly female, being taken, brutally murdered, and we have even a little one. You know, the gender-based violence is not only adult women as well, mm-hmm. in Trinidad and Tobago. We see little girls where sexual abuse is rampant and incest. We see situations where domestically a man might say, listen, you are my property. Mm-hmm. If I can't have you, no one else will. And you're seeing situations where the woman is killed because she's trying to leave the relationship. So in Trinidad and Tobago in particular, we have a very nasty problem where that is concerned.
You know, I have to ask you the same question, Margaret. From your line of work, how prevalent is it today? And we're talking about the fact that we've had these discussions so often about violence and violence against women, but is it as prevalent as it was, let's say, 4 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago?
I would add a difference into Dr. Douglas's what she said, in that it's increasing, and it may be because of the interventions that we have been having with the persons. We are availing the Victim and Witness Support Unit, the Trinidad and Tobago Police Service. We are availing opportunities for persons to come and be able to exist in an environment where they feel safe, be able to interact and network with agencies so that they can get some support and so on. Yes, the gender-based violence, it is becoming, for me, a crisis state. Mm-hmm. And unless we take our heads from out of the sand, all the agencies coming on board, both hands on the wheel, we are going to see both male and female and our children existing in critical situations for sustained periods of time.
Now, the fallout or the long-term implications of existing in these critical situations for extended periods of time, Dr. Douglas, what are we talking about?
You're talking about an overall reduction in your ability to value yourself. Mm-hmm. That is the first fallout, where your sense of self-worth is eroded continually. Because if you're talking about, and I'm looking particularly at domestic violence, where the violence is continual, you have a situation where this is the person that you love. And if this is the person I love, and this person claims to love me, and they are beating on me, or they are insulting me, or they are withholding resources from me, because there are many different kinds mm-hmm. of violence and abuse. Mm-hmm. The issue is you then start to wonder about your worth and value.
Isn't that anything that makes you question your worth can be considered violence or can be considered abuse?
Well, you see, it really depends there. That is a very interesting definition, but sometimes there are things that may make us question our worth that as adults we do mm-hmm. and we have done to ourselves. But really and truly what we're talking about is because of being female, this is what we're talking about when we say gender-based, right? Or being female or being male, just because of your gender, this is what is causing the violence. This is what is saying to the person that they have permission to be violent against you. But here's the thing as well. This day is not only about violence that is gender-based. Mm-hmm. Today, it's about violence against women in particular. Yeah. Against women in particular. And so we are seeing across the board that there is this view that women are in a particular position in the society. There's a particular view of the woman that says your worth and value just because you are female is of a lower value. And therefore, we do not have to give you the same kind of respect that is needed.
The kind mm-hmm. of respect needed. Now, Akash Samaru standing by for the 6:30 news update. Then we have a brief news update. Akash, good morning. How are you? What are we following in news this morning?
Hi, good morning, Hima. Good morning, Trinidad and Tobago. Well, Hima, news out of the PNM camp. It's really exciting here because I know everything was going kind of smoothly for the PNM with this screening process. You know, they started it early and whatnot. You know, they were getting ahead of the pack.
They were teaching everybody
how to do it. Right. And now we have Mr. Patrick Manning, who is apparently saying, well, you know what, I think I want to, you know, keep my seat in San Fernando East. Now, Hema, last year for the local elections, I remembered something, and I don't know if the director could help me here by just playing that quick clip for me, please.
I have already said that when I finish with this term of office, I am going to ride off into the sunset.
Well, it appears the sunset may be back into his constituency office, right? You know, I've changed my mind on things before. You know, I was going to wear something different. I changed my mind this morning. Mr. Manning is very well entitled to change his mind as well. But last year he was saying, well, that's it for him and electoral politics. I remember, you know, getting a bit of an earful from him from calling him at home. He doesn't really like that, especially nowadays. And he says he's done with that.
So he's confirmed that he is running?
Well, there was a town meeting last evening in his constituency, where he was a member of the panel. He didn't speak, of course. You know, sometimes it is healthy.
Right.
He can't really speak as much. But a representative did say that he would like to submit his name for, you know, consideration to Dr. Rowley. Now, it will be really interesting if they tell Patrick Manning, no. The PNM turns to Patrick Manning, who I believe San Fernando is what, 43 years?
Yeah, he's the longest serving MP in the
Parliament. Right, if you turn to Patrick Manning and you say, well, Mr. Manning, hard luck. I would like to see the backlash.
Akash, well, thanks so much. I know that you did have some big announcements.
I'm too excited.
It's always interesting. I don't know. Maybe we'll see Mr. Pandey throwing his hat back in the ring. We take a very short break. When we come back, Marcus Kisun also joined these women on set as we look at not only violence against gender-based violence, but violence against women. Today, we're talking activism. Stay with us.
This season wasn't merry. No one was feeling jolly. Then B-Mobile came out fancy to give away big money. Merry, merry money. Aye, aye, aye. Merry, merry money with Link B-Mobile. When you top up 30, your pay your bills quickly. You win thousands weekly. Inviting everybody. Merry, merry money. Aye, aye, aye. Merry, merry money with Link B-Mobile.
Debt Recovery and Administrative Services Limited, the leader in debt collections for over 15 years. Our advanced technological approach continues to make us number one. Call or visit us online for more information. Because when things don't go as planned, we are here to keep you afloat.
Coastsides invites all shrimp lovers to enjoy the mouth-watering shrimp dishes. New on the menu, dal, rice, and curry shrimp. Go ahead, ask about our new tamarind sauce. Coastsides Roti Shop, Trinidad's premier roti shop. Arriba, Tuna Puna, Sawa, for the space.
Hi, I'm James Saunders. That's right, the anchor man with a breaking news story that takes you beyond pigtails, quality, barbecue, deprivation.
Even as a chef, I have experienced this, but no more.
As a world-renowned Olympic medalist, I have had unadulterated barbecue privilege, and it weighs heavily on my conscience, which is why I've joined Wendy's Barbecue Pork for TNT cause to help fight barbecue pork inaccessibility.
Today, Wendy's have delivered where others failed.
By bringing truly mouth-watering barbecue pulled pork to the Trinbagonian market.
Yeah. Barbecue.
Pulled.
Pork.
Wendy's Barbecue
for TNT. Together, we can help the barbecue pulled deprive.
Wendy's. Now that's better.
When The Guardian rolls off the press, something more than news travels throughout the country. Like awareness from in-depth investigations that explore every role. And insightful reporting that you can be passionate about. There's satisfaction for those who need a higher level of analysis and confidence in well-researched information that gives you the edge. Even quality time from a family of entertaining features, online or offline.
So whoever, wherever you are, trust The Guardian to deliver what matters.
Begin your university degree in January 2015. The University of the Southern Caribbean does not just offer degrees in education, business, humanities, social sciences, science and technology, and theology. We prepare you for life. CAPE, CSEC, and adult entry options are available. Sign up today at any of our campuses in Maracas, St. Joseph, San Fernando, or Tobago, and let USC take you beyond excellence.
This holiday season, decorate your home from Grand Source. We have a wide range of exquisite bedroom sets, TV stands, wardrobes, and a lot more beautiful household accessories. So come on down to Grand Source, 121 Monroe Road, Kunopia, 693-2421. Open Sunday, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m.
Par Excellence is the number one housewife's choice in Trinidad and Tobago and is now introducing a new range of products. Jasmine rice, pet rice, basmati rice, soybean oil, and much more. Available at leading supermarkets nationwide.
Welcome back, Trinidad and Tobago. We're talking about 16 days of activism and Diane Douglas, and also we have Margaret Sampson-Brown and Marcus Kisoon is here to give these ladies another perspective about activism and violence. Now, you know, Margaret, we're talking about women and feeling safe to come forward. And I have to bring this back to a story on, I think it was the last public holiday that we had, where a young woman went to a police station because she obviously told her loved ones. And I remember the grandmother speaking about this. So she said she was fed up of the situation with the man, mm-hmm. that she's convinced he's going to kill her. Mm-hmm. She went to a police station at 8 o'clock in the morning, and by 1 o'clock in the evening, she was dead. Her and two male relatives were dead because the man just walked into the house and opened fire, yeah. killing her. Yeah. How do we encourage women to feel safe to go and report when that woman is an example of somebody who has reports, who has made that report? Yeah. And even when that's this concept of a restraining order and even making a police report, you are putting yourself in even greater danger.
Hey, well, let me just say this. When someone comes and make a report to the police about a domestic violence situation, and I would kind of draw on Dr. Douglas's remark when she said that it's your loved one that you are reporting. When you make that report, how would a police officer determine that if she goes back home, he would kill her? She may say that. And perhaps the training of a police officer is critical so that when that person makes that report, that initial kind of behavior should be an aggressive one, so that they perhaps visit the home. But we have had reports, Hima, where the police officer visited the home and when they left, the person was killed. We have had reports where the police officer would have given the applicant advice. They're going to the court, apply for protection order, but from the court, on the way from the court, they were killed. And there are different things. It's almost as if it's a small half and a big half in respect of domestic violence situation. Hence the reason we are saying to all applicants, all persons who are existing in domestic violence situation, be it male or female, that they come to the police and make the report. And of course, if you feel that you're not safe making it to the report to the police, the victim and witness support officers would be there to support you. And really take you through the process. It's not an easy thing. We have a situation the other night where a person who is pregnant in a domestic violence situation and unable to stay in her home because the perpetrator, who is her husband, is engaging in a behavior that is certainly not safe for her, her unborn baby, and her two children. And there's another person involved in that situation. When we were able to intervene and whatever, but how do we deal with a situation like that? She's 8 months pregnant, and she's existing in a situation that is almost critical.
Marcus, you had to give another side of this story because, you know, we're talking about, and maybe even I am guilty of it because I've known so many women that have been victims of domestic violence and they have been subjected to the most denigrating and degrading circumstances. Mm-hmm. But men are also victims, I guess, and anybody who's hurting will hurt people.
Yeah, something that I like to conceptualize is that men are now the marginalized group within this social issue because, I mean, we know that one in every three girls are victims, but according to Latin America and the US, is one in every six men who would be sexually abused before his 18th birthday. And society has put us in a place where men are not supposed to talk about these things. So I just want to know that gender-based violence affects all genders and all sexes, and we need to not just focus on one particular group, but be culturally competent to deal with all persons, especially men, because we have men walking around who have unmasked their childhood traumas, and that's why we have so much aggression, so much hate, so much unhealthy ways of dealing with situations. So we need to look at men issue, and if we don't want to look at men as being primarily victims of like sexual crimes, but let's look at gender-based violence on men as the court systems who don't pay attention to men with children hearing and custody hearing and that kind of thing, because people think that the ideal place to put children is with the mothers and not having proper assessments to give men that safe space to be like, okay, I could be a father too. Right.
Giving a safe space. And speaking about safety, Dr. Douglas, you know, we've had this conversation so many times. Our women stay in situations, even though you know in your heart that I am worth more and I should not stay in this situation. But yet, because of fear or for whatever reason, financial, economic, comfort, because it's funny, there is this, I think, a psychological thing where you have become accustomed to the drama and to the pain. And if it's not there, you feel as though things are just going awry in your life. The safety zone and getting women to understand that that is not a safe place.
You know, Hema, there are some things you said that I want to touch on there. Getting into a certain habit, getting accustomed to certain things. I and financially, I mean, that's one of the number one reasons why women might stay in a situation, but there's another reason too. Many women you speak to, especially those who have children in domestic violence situations, they will say to you that maybe they did not have a good family situation growing up. They made a commitment that when they create their own family, that their children would have an intact family. And some of the women are staying in this situation because they want their children to be in an intact family with a father and a mother, a dream they had. But we want our women to be safe. And for any of us who've ever moved house, you will understand how hard it is to move from a situation. You know how traumatic it is to move? What it takes? Imagine now, particularly in a domestic violence situation. I mean, there are many other forms of violence, but I'm particularly focused on domestic violence. It is very difficult to leave because you have an established home. All your things are there, your family, friends. This is where you reside. And so we want to say to women, because we do not want to take from women the ability to choose. If you choose to stay in a situation where there is violence, we want you to create a safety plan. And this is why I am referring to a manual we created for this, Hema, because I want it to be very clear. You must plan in advance. You choose to stay in a situation of violence. You feel you have no other choice, then you must have a safety plan. You have to plan in advance. You have to have close to you always all those crisis intervention numbers, those hotline numbers, to be able to call the police, the victim support, you know, Margaret Sampson Brown and her team, so you'll be able to call them. You have the number close by. If you have children, you have to teach your children how to call the emergency numbers. This is very important because you see, you have to be in a place of readiness in case you have to leave.
But do women understand the need to be in that place of readiness? Do you understand? Because, you know, a lot of times I you know, you don't think that this person is capable of doing this, of taking it to the extent that I see Marcus shaking. So you feel as though there must be love somewhere. And if a slap passes or a cuff or a kick or a push or a shove, I don't think it's going to reach to the point where somebody's going to physically take a gun or a knife and do away with me. Do you?
They do, Hema. They do feel afraid. Many of them do. Very few women in domestic violence situation, maybe at the very beginning, but if this thing goes on and on, many of them are afraid. I don't know, I see Margaret. Look.
But do you find that? Do women come in and they say, and I'll ask Marcus about his experience, I know you work with the Rape Crisis Society as well, that they come and say, well, I know that this is not right, but I just can't because I love him and I don't think that he's going to do this to me. Do they say that?
Well,
I'm listening to Dan, and I'm saturated with it because I know there are some situations that go beyond that. Mm-hmm. That people, there are some families that have nowhere to go. Hmm. They have nobody to contact. Their relatives have made them, the perpetrators imprisoned them in this place. Right. And I.
But they are afraid, aren't they?
They're afraid.
They're very afraid.
Now, what we're saying is that didn't the victim mm-hmm. call somebody from a male situation to call her husband and say, listen, or call the perpetrator and say, listen, could you talk with him? Why is it that we women always have to be the ones to run, to hide, to pick up and leave the situation? How is it, isn't it possible that the male could call like Marcus? Marcus mm-hmm. set up something that if the woman is seeing a crisis building, she can say, listen, there's a number and I can call where they can call the perpetrator and talk with him.
Marcus, from your experience, do you see that?
The fear is very much there. I think it goes right back to childhood experience, mm-hmm. where if you don't train your children to deal with fear and know what is safety and love, mm-hmm. they can't leave. Mm-hmm. That is a safe, that violent situation is a safe zone for women. They don't know what it is to get out of a situation like that. Coalition always says that it takes about 7 to 8 beatings before a woman actually leaves a situation mm-hmm. or asks for intervention. Mm-hmm. So we have to let our children, society has to prepare our people to know that if you are hurting, this is hurt, this is love. Yeah. This is where you come to understand it. Mm-hmm. With the whole male scenario, I believe men are allies in this situation. I have one more orange today, like my colleagues here, right? We need on a Sunday evening when we go to play football, and Akash will tell you, we need to sit down as boys and say, listen, this is not how you deal with a situation, right? I hope you don't cuss your girlfriend like this, how you just cuss on the field. Right? This is what men need to start doing to other men.
Oh, you said men need to start doing.
Yes.
Because I was wondering, Marcus, if you were saying that they are doing that.
But I do it.
But a lot of men don't do that.
Yes.
They talk in the bar. They talk as they study at tertiary level education. It's not about how can we be respectful to our woman?
Yeah.
No, the talk is how to outsmart our woman. The talk is don't get caught. The talk is how to disrespect. The talk is how to hide your money. There's a general tone in our society where men and women are pitted against each other and are taught to mistrust each other. We do not stand for each other. And some of this is the reason why the violence continues. So when you say, Hema, about men intervening, we have to, if we want our women to survive, to teach them how to create their own safety plan. Because very often they cannot call on another man to be able to speak to their husband. As a matter of fact, there is a code. There is a code among the men that says, this is my woman, his house, you know, my house, you don't come. Men do not see that they should intervene in situations where another man, I'm talking generally, of course, where another man should come in and speak to a man about what his castle, his household, oh, no. That is not something that men tend to do in our society.
Over the years, we have been saying to a woman, do this, do this, do this. We have to start talking to a man. Mm-hmm. They have ears too. Mm-hmm. We have to start talking to a man.
But why do you think women are so, and I know we have a couple seconds to wrap, why are women so hesitant? Because you have that support group that women give to each other.
Yes.
So, you know, even if I'm in a bad relationship, I will have friends come and say, well, you know, this is really not something that's good for you. Mm-hmm. You women do that. Why do you not see it to the point where it's actually insisting that the way in the U.S. it's done, that there is a point where you actually leave or, you know, or there's a safety place to go to? Your closing comments, Margaret, as we wrap this interview.
To the women and men on Trinidad and Tobago, there's so much love floating around that we need to absorb some of it. And if you're in a situation, talk to somebody, make a report, come to the Victim and Witness Support Unit. We will support you. If you can't come, we will come to you. The safety plan, yes, but sometimes some of the women forget the safety plan in their crisis. But we want to let you know that there's help, there's hope, because we are looking for harmony in Trinidad and Tobago.
Diane, your closing comments.
I want women to know
that they can receive psychological care as well, that they do not have, if they've ever been a victim, to be a victim for the rest of their lives, that you can live a wholesome life even if you have experienced violence, to seek professional help. Also, I want to say to those who are in situations where you are very, very scared for your life, have that safety plan. Make sure you have support around you to be able to exit quickly if need be in order to save your life.
10 seconds, Marcus.
Yes. 16 years of activism. I just want everybody to know that you don't have to be flying to the UN every Friday morning to be an activist. Wear orange, change your attitude towards thinking, don't victim blame, and know that if your friends are hurting people, talk to them, intervene. That is a real activist.
That is a real activist, one change at a time. We take a very short break. When we come back, we talk about the situation in Tobago. Diane Haddad joins us on set. She's the head of the Tobago arm of the Trinidad and Tobago Chamber of Industry and Commerce. What does this murder mean, not only for the island, but for tourism and business prospects? Stay with us.
No, you don't have to have no big set of money for outdoor furniture of first-class quality.
Patio One brings creativity, elegance, and style to your outdoor surroundings, dining sets, and more for your patio.
Patio One is ahead for true. They have outdoor furnishings for you.
Group Narayan Complex, Karuni, Savannah Road, or visit our showroom, Wrightson Road, Port of Spain.
After school, huh?
You would not do this to yourself, so why do it to others?
Teasing,
taunting, or hurting someone
is not a nice thing to do.
Teachers, parents,
you could end a child's suffering by simply paying attention to the signs.
Talk to your kids, teach them to recognize and speak up about bad things.
That's the first step.
Together, we can defeat this problem.
I'm sorry.
Are you okay?
Good. Let's go play. Okay.
Play fair, live fair, because all children deserve to be their best.
Seaview Optical announces their 2015 Michael Kors and Coach promotions. With the purchase of all Michael Kors and Coach frames, get 25% off plus 50% off all Michael Kors and Coach sunglasses. Complete single vision lenses with frames at $299. Bifocal lenses with frame, $479. Latest on all Cruzal Sapphire, Provencia and Avance lenses. Seaview Optical, affordable eye care for everyone. Woodville is clearing out one of its warehouses for good. Prices like never before, warehouses must be cleared. Five-piece bedroom set from $5,995. Seven-piece dining sets from $1,995. Living room sets from $2,995. And many more items priced to clear. Green Dot Limited. Wireless, digital, cable, and internet masters. No phone lines necessary. Quick and easy installation. Unlimited internet access. Call 623-4643 and be part of the Green Dot today.
Better Value Limited says this is the one. Come to our one-day sale this Wednesday, 26 November, and get 15% off everything store-wide for cash and links transactions. No exceptions, no gimmicks. This is your opportunity to save big on Christmas items. Giftware, housewares, toys, mini appliances, cosmetics, and fragrances. One day only, so don't miss out. Plus, get 10% off on all credit card transactions. Better Value Limited, Hussein's Plaza Gulfview and Hussein's Mall, Princess Town.
Thank you. Welcome back, Trinidad and Tobago. I'm Hema Ramkisoon. Joining us on set now, Ms. Diane Haddad, and she is the head of the Tobago arm of the Trinidad and Tobago Chamber of Industry and Commerce. And we're talking about another blow for Tobago as it relates to business and tourism. Ms. Haddad, good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Morning, Hema. Morning, Trinidad and Tobago.
What's your thoughts on what's taking place since last week, Friday, on your beautiful island of Tobago?
Well, it was a sad day on Saturday when I got the call as to what had happened. It's devastating to all of us who have really worked hard over the last couple of years to ensure that we kind of get the whole tourism business bouncing back. Mm-hmm. And we were really looking forward to a great season. However, this really doesn't do us any good because it brings back the memories of the green situation 5 years ago. Of course, internationally, it's all over social media now. Mm-hmm. And it's just not going to... We had the Apollo flight that started last year, winter, and we had some negatives in terms of how the people were treated at particular resorts. We had to go and do damage control. There was a lot of work that had to be done, you know, to get us to where we are this year that we were looking forward to. So this is really not sounding good. It's not feeling good.
Now, are you concerned about the repercussions and the fallouts? I know Akash Samra is standing by for the news updates. We're going to go to Akash and come immediately back to this interview as we find out what are the possible fallouts and how are we going to begin the damage control and the crisis management team that has already been put in place. We're going to check in with Akash Samra.
Good morning, I'm Akash Samaru, and this is your morning news here on CNC3 and at the TBC Radio Network. The attorney representing Asmon Alexander says his client is being treated badly while in police custody. Alexander, who was labeled as the country's most wanted man, was held in Malabar on Sunday. He was wanted in connection with the recent Brasso Seko murders, but his lawyer, Farid Ali, tells CNC3 he visited his client last evening and is not happy with what he saw and was told. He said Alexander has a cut on his right ankle in addition to a swollen wrist. Mr. Ali says Alexander complained about not receiving his prescribed medication and also not being given a bath since his capture. The attorney also says that random police officers are taking pictures of him. Mr. Ali says it is alarming that the senior officers in charge of the station are allowing this to happen. A former Prime Minister and San Fernando East MP, Patrick Manning, says he wants to contest the seat in the next general election. The former Prime Minister has been recovering from a stroke he suffered back in January 2012. Mr. Manning, who has been the MP for San Fernando East for the last 43 years, indicated in the past he will not be contesting the seat in the 2015 general elections as he is in the sunset of his political career. In fact, this is what Mr. Manning told our cameraman Ivan Tulsi last year after he voted in the local government election.
We've already said that when I finish with this term of office, I am going to ride off into the sunset.
Well, yesterday he was expected to endorse the person he wanted to see contest the San Fernando East seat. Well, at the Pleasantville Community Center last evening, Mr. Manning said he wants to contest the seat if his health permits. He says he will now approach political leader Dr. Keith Rowley about his decision. The People's National Movement has been screening prospective candidates to contest the next general election. Acting Police Commissioner Stephen Williams says he has put together a strong, experienced team of officers to solve the murder of a German couple in Tobago on Saturday. He made the announcement after meeting with THA Chief Secretary Orville London and THA officials. It comes as the island braces for a backlash on its main economy, tourism.
It's a matter which is receiving the highest level of policing attention. I have assigned the assistant commissioner with responsibility for homicide investigations in Trinidad and Tobago to lead this investigation in Tobago.
And internationally, the St. Louis suburb of Ferguson has seen rioting and looting after a jury decided to not bring charges over the killing of Michael Brown. A police chief said violence in the Missouri town was probably much worse than the worst unrest after the black teenager was killed in August. St. Louis County Police Chief John Belmer said rioters had fired over 150 bullets. Michael Brown was shot by a white police officer, Darren Wilson, on August 9th, sparking protests. And that was your 7 a.m. news here on CNC3 and the TBC Radio Network. Let's jump right back into the Morning Brew with Eva Ramke soon.
Welcome back, Trinidad and Tobago, and we are jumping straight back into our conversation with Diane Haddad. We're talking about damage control, crisis management. Obviously, yesterday, United Front, the Minister of Tourism, the head of the THA, the police commissioner, everyone in Scarborough to condemn these acts. But that's not enough. The story is on international media.
It's definitely not enough. Disappointingly, I'm hearing our acting commissioner say that they're sending a high-profile team and whatever. Number one, that sends several signals. It means we don't have the expertise on the island to deal with any sort of crime situation. And therefore, we're still in the dependency syndrome of Trinidad having to come to rescue Tobago. The Greens matter was never resolved. They did not reach murder.
Right.
But it is because we did not attend to anything properly in the first place that we keep having to deal with these reactions, and we're operating in crisis mode.
Now, you are in crisis mode. What are you going to do? This is obviously the peak season, Ms. Haddad. The European market, this is when they come to the Caribbean for the Christmas season. You have Carnival. What do you think needs to be done? If you had to advise a THA this morning, what would you tell them?
Well, really and truly, there needs to be the presence of the police in a preventative manner. They need to be out there visually in terms of people feeling that level of confidence. Let's all say that these are foreigners that were attacked, but what about the people who reside on the island? This doesn't make you feel extremely great. I mean, no robbery in sight, two people hacked to death. I mean, it doesn't make you feel very good even as a resident of Trinidad and Tobago. Let's go back to all the other murders that have not been solved, right? Even Dana Sitahal. We have had nothing coming out of our police service in terms of results. And that, for me, is where the issue lies, because then people feel they have the right to, because at this stage, criminals are probably brighter than the rest. That's where the problem really is.
Now, looking at the fact that the criminals seem to believe that they are brighter than the rest, the fact that the conviction rate is not supporting that, are you worried that tourism will take a direct hit as a result of this? It's all over the international media.
Well, we are not the only country or island that has had a tourism negative experience. I mean, I have had things happen with me when you travel. However, yes, it leaves a bad taste in the mouth of the person who experienced it, but there will always be the expectation that I will go and have a good time. We are hoping that the damage control is done hard enough and soon enough that, and we as a people have to stand up. We in Tobago have to march. We have to speak out. We have to say we're not tolerating it. We have to send a message. We have to speak out to ensure that our visitors are happy when they get to us. So the whole island has to change its mood now.
The whole island must change its mood. And it's I have to ask whether or not, because I know there was an interview with the Greens, and they say that they continue to warn people about Tobago.
Well, Mr. Green, I heard him on television at the interview, said that all he got was £2,400 in conversion. In terms of compensation, I'm not sure how they were dealt with in terms of the actual operation, you know, because, again, do we have the right hospital systems? Are we treating people well? Do we really take an emergency as an emergency? Mr. Green's experience obviously was not good, right? He said he's going to sue the government of Trinidad and Tobago. Can we afford it? Was it worthwhile to treat somebody well rather than have a lawsuit for $20 million TT dollars, is what it sounds like now? Should we use our money differently? Should we treat our people? Should we train our people differently? The whole country's in that mode, I'm sorry to say, but that's just where it is. We need to love.
We need to love and actually train. And can we get this situation or handle the crisis mode effectively? Your closing comments, Trinidad and Tobago, Ms. Haddad.
Leadership is a serious word. We have to take it seriously, from parenting, from being a sister, brother, aunt. I'm going to keep saying it, the priests, the teachers, our justice system, our police officers, our politicians. Leadership is a serious role. And if we do not take that and start to be exemplars or examples for what is behind us, we will never fix this.
assessing the leadership and the type of leadership that we're witnessing, if you just look at the papers, I think you'll question exactly where we are as a nation, but we as a people must take a part in shifting and changing the conversation. We take a very short break. When we come back, we'll have more for you. This is The Morning Brew.
I've been shopping at Mirage Westside Supermarket for over 50 years, and I get my groceries home and drop free.
They have the best prices and the best quality that I could think of.
They have heavy security.
Over three different places to park.
You're shopping comfort.
I'm not going anywhere else to shop, but
actually, I am one of their very first customers way back in the 60s.
Mirage Westside Supermarket, serving you for the past 50 years.
Even as we expect that everything changes in time, there's a magic to the way Shagoramus is transforming into one of the region's most idyllic investment and entertainment destinations. Perfectly located on the picturesque northwestern peninsula, the potential of this breathtaking landscape is being realized through the vision of the Shagoramus Development Authority, CDA. Explore the adventure that is rapidly becoming fabulous Shagoramus. The excitement, the thrills, the romance of the boardwalk. This is your invitation to a whole new world of opportunity. Shagoramus, somewhere close to magic.
For this Christmas, buy a unique gift which will make you remember Christmas all year round. African Trophies is making that easy with a massive 40% discount on all items throughout the month of December. We urge you not to miss this very special opportunity. African Trophies, 39 Tragrit Road, Port of Spain. Phone 622-9476.
Party Central, where all your dreams can come true this Christmas, with gifts for everyone, glassware and candy bowls and mugs for all. And don't forget your Santa suits for men, ladies, and accessories too. Deck the halls with gingerbread men, candles, pillows, and snowmen too. Whether naughty or nice, we have the gift to fit your price. So come on down to Party Central. We are open from Monday to Friday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. on Saturdays. For more information, call 222-7781.
Par Excellence is the number one housewife's choice in Trinidad and Tobago and is now introducing a new range of products. White rice, parboiled rice, white sugar, brown sugar, and much more. Available at leading supermarkets nationwide.
Welcome back, Trinidad and Tobago. I'm Hema Ramkisoon, and this is The Morning Brew. Now, yesterday, we saw a call by senior members, not only of the judiciary, but even the head of state of Trinidad and Tobago, and that is President Carmona, talking about the need for mediation, for us to get our act together, for us to find meaningful dialogue or the path to meaningful dialogue. Now, the feature speaker at yesterday's event was the Chief Justice of Rwanda. In case you didn't know, in 1994, Rwanda's population of 7 million was comprised of basically three ethnic groups, and the world would never forget the story. For 3 weeks in April of 1994, and this is after the plane carrying the then president was shot down, violence began almost immediately. And in that 1 week, you saw almost 1 million men, women, and children perished in the Rwandan genocide, perhaps as almost three-quarter of the Tutsi population at that time. At the same time, thousands of Hutu tribe members were murdered because they were opposed to the killing campaigns. This is a nation that basically was fueled, or an entire genocide that was fueled by a conscious choice of the elite to promote hatred and fear and keep itself in power. Fast forward to 2014, and this nation is healing. The Chief Justice is here this morning as one of our main guests to talk about the fact that you can actually heal a nation that has come out of so much turmoil. And is it even possible, and what can we learn from the systems? And we also have Justice Vashish Kukaram joining us on set, and as you know, he is the head of the Mediation Board of Trinidad and Tobago. Good morning, gentlemen. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning.
Now, my first question to you, Mr. Bujiji, in terms of Rwanda and the genocide, when I read the history of that piece, you know, you look at the fact that your country was literally torn apart by war, a war fueled by hatred. Were you in Rwanda during the genocide?
I wasn't.
And when you stood on the outside and you looked at the international media, the stories coming out, because at that time people felt as though the world turned its back on Rwanda. How did you feel looking at the stories coming out of Rwanda?
It was horrible. It was horrible to watch bodies flowing in the rivers, bodies littering the streets. It was very depressing.
Now, you know, if you look at your stories, and obviously you, there was a fear factor. May I ask what tribe you belong to? Or can I ask about your heritage?
We don't work in with tribes. We are now all Rwandese, and that's what we've been working on for the last 20 years.
Has that been accepted? Do people now see themselves as citizens of Rwanda as opposed to the ethnic and tribal groups?
Yes, they do.
Now, I want to ask about the healing process and how the judiciary has assisted in healing, because I know that Justice Kukaram is part of the Mediation Board of Trinidad and Tobago. But when we talk about the genocide, and you know that you looked at your country literally being ripped apart at that time, what is the one moment or the one thing that you remember most about that time?
As I say, it was horrible, and it was devastating to see neighbors killing neighbors, and on no other ground except that they were born in a particular ethnic group. And to know that at some point in history, people lived peacefully together, but because of colonial intervention and the policy of divide and rule, people ended up recognizing or looking for differences, and with the preaching of hatred, started hating each other and killing each other. And of course, it was the minority group that suffered. And I think from that time on, when it was all over, the hope of all of us who survived and those who came from outside was that no longer would this happen again. We have to work together as a nation. We had been abandoned by the international community, so it was up to us as Rwandese people to unite ourselves into one nation once again and work together for the development of our country.
Now, you know, before I get into how the judicial system actually attempted this or attempted to heal this nation, Justice Kukaram, why did you choose Mr. Bujiji as the feature speaker? What is it about the Rwandan experience that you think you would like to leave the Trinidad and Tobago, the lesson with the Trinidad and Tobago judiciary? What lesson would you like to leave with them?
To show that no matter what conflict, no matter how serious the conflict, how emotive the conflict, there can be a peaceful solution if parties are dedicated to a peaceful future. And that's the simple theme. And it applies to the Rwandan society, it applies to litigation in Trinidad, it applies to so many disputes that envelop family life, communities, political life. And that's the main theme. And the building blocks really are in the story of the Rwandan story. It's a graphic story, mm-hmm. It's an extreme story, but we can tease out of it the elements of what makes conflict and what makes peace.
What makes conflict and what makes peace? You have been asked, Mr. Chief Justice, to not only establish but to strengthen the laws of justice and the judicial system in a country that has been ripped apart by hate, a country that has been abandoned, as you said, and I have rightly said as well, by the international will. Why accept this task? And when you came into this position, did you see it as an insurmountable challenge to start this healing process or to start from somewhere?
Well, I took over from others who
began
had
that
been
process, yes.
In that process. And I must say, it was not, you couldn't deal with justice separated from everything else. I think after the genocide, immediately after the genocide, the first thing to do was to establish peace and security for everybody so that people could feel safe. And then we looked at justice. How do we bring about justice? And this was in the context of previous killings, previous massacres from 1959 up to 1994. There had been waves of massacres against the Tutsis. So we had to look for a way of putting an end to this impunity. People had killed and got amnesty. Now we said we are not going to give people amnesty. They must answer for their crimes. No, and that is how the judiciary and the justice system come in to ensure that there is responsibility for the crimes committed, while at the same time we look at ways of healing the nation and reuniting the nation.
I read something about it's like a Kaka system.
Gachacha
system.
Yes.
That was intended to avoid revenge and to promote the rule of law.
Right.
The provisions aimed at reconciliation amongst the communities.
Right.
This is what I thought was interesting, and I guess you and Justice Kukram can clarify this. The sentencing provisions, which allowed for substantial reductions of sentence,
yes,
for those who confessed and asked for forgiveness. How is this bringing about justice? Because if you look at in a country that so much bloodshed had occurred, if you say that I have now accepted, first maybe you can explain what the court system is, what the judicial system is, and then this concept of sentencing with those who confessed and those who have asked for forgiveness.
Mm. Well, the system is that the Gachacha court system is an ancient institution which we have modified. In the old days, it was the elders of the community, I think like many other traditional societies.
Right. So is it like a tribal court?
Well, something like that. Except in Rwanda, we have one tribe, we are Banyarwanda.
I have to keep remembering that, right?
Yes. The members of the community would have their own elders, like clan elders, clan leaders, who would then sit in judgment whenever a problem arose. But their purpose was not so much to punish, but rather to get the people to be reconciled where it was necessary to give, to restore the position as it was before, or to give some compensation where it could not be restored. And this was modified after the genocide in the sense that this time it was not elders of the community, but rather people elected by the community from among themselves who were considered to be people of integrity, people who are honest, and who are wise enough to understand the dispute and to resolve the dispute.
Now, if it is, you look at the sentencing provision, I know that I will also ask Justice Kukram to comment on this, and we're talking about the sentencing aspect of it, because the purpose of a court is to balance justice, where the rights of the victim and those who are guilty will be properly punished for the crimes committed.
Yes. Yes.
When you say that and I don't know if I've gotten this right, but the sentencing provisions, they allowed for substantial reductions of sentences for those who confessed and asked for forgiveness. How in a country where people are demanding that those who are responsible for the bloodshed be held or completely thrown to the wolves, how were you able to get them to accept that?
Well, indeed, as you say, it is a question of balance between the interests of the victim for justice and to punish the person who committed a crime. At the same time, we have an interest in keeping the society together. Remember that in Rwanda, hundreds of thousands of people had got involved in the commission of the crime of genocide. They had killed, they had looted, they had destroyed property. So the important question was, how do we get for these people to recognize their wrongdoing at the same time, make sure we don't pull the society apart even more. We couldn't put hundreds of thousands of people in jail. We didn't have the capacity for that. And it was not good for the future of the nation. So we came up with this innovative way of dealing with the situation, that those who accepted their responsibility assisted in locating where the bodies of the victims were buried and so on, so that they could be reburied in dignity, could then get some remission or some reduction of their sentences, which sentences could be served partly in prison and partly outside prison in community work.
Now, Justice Kukrama, what can we learn from that in terms of, you know, I listened to this and I still I'm amazed that as a population that was ripped apart by hate and war, that people can say, let's not persecute this even further. Let's all accept that this, as a nation, we must come together as one people and move forward. What do you think that we and our democracy can accept that? Or what do you want the judiciary to learn from this?
I mean, Hima, it's a fantastic story. And we have to roll back the question, what is justice? And there's a famous Indian commentator who said, peace is the fruit of justice. Mm-hmm. And what are the ends of justice? And you can see from the Chief Justice, his description of the judicial system, the purpose of that system was to keep the country together. So you, if the aims of justice is to heal and to keep your society together and to be part of a network of nation building, you need to be innovative. And these are the themes coming out of that story. You need to think outside the box. You need to go back to your roots. You need to think about who you are and who you are as a people and who do you want to be as a people, right, in a peaceful nation. So let's translate that story to Trinidad. In both the civil and the criminal system, does it make sense in the criminal system to punish for every crime? Or is there a system where we can rehabilitate, we can reconcile, we can get victims and offenders working together to build a nation? That is the story in the criminal system.
Now,
so in fact, we are now, the Chief Justice, Archie, is leading the way with innovations in the judicial system of drug treatment courts, juvenile courts, and a way of trying to reform offenders. In the very same story of, it does not make sense, the retributive system
versus a restorative.
That's right.
Now, you know, if you look at retributive and restorative justice, and I know that mediation was also a key part of building or forming this judicial system, because you basically had to build it from scratch following the genocide. How does a country adopt or adapt to this fundamental change in the grand norm before and after coming into force of the new constitution? Because your constitution was basically suspended, disintegrated, and you had, I know that you yielded a lot from or gained a lot from the English experience with a lot of English lawyers coming in to assist that. How does the country then go through that to adapt to these changes when there's nothing to accept law and order now?
Well, given that vision that we had of a united nation from a tattered social fabric, the Constitution of 2003 came in to transform the whole way, the way we look at things, to include protection for fundamental rights, to include independence of the judiciary, separation of powers, to bring in, importantly, the sharing of power between the political parties. Remember that the one group, the RPF, which had stopped the genocide, had a political party which could have taken all the power. But because of the vision of uniting the people, we started with a government of national unity, picking people from different political groups,
right,
to form a government. And in the Constitution, we put that not more than 50% of the government can be from one political party. however much they might have got at elections. So this constitution comes in that context of how do we mold a United Nation and protect it and get away from a past of abuse of rights and establish a regime of rights where people know that they are protected and they can always resist any government or whatever group that wants to take them back to divisive politics.
Now, resultable state governed by the rule of law based on respect for fundamental rights, a pluralistic democracy, equitable power sharing, tolerance, and resolution of issues through dialogue. And I know that mediation committees are also. But you know, when I look at this and I listen to what Justice Cochran has said, using mediation and restorative justice techniques for criminal matters and for matters that fall before the criminal courts, how do you begin that process? Because you come back to the basic right of the victim and the rights of those who want to see the perpetrators thrown to the wolves, and they want to feel as though there is justice. You look at what's happening in Ferguson, Missouri this morning, yes, where they feel aggrieved that the justice system has failed them.
Yes. Well, it is because we've had dialogue. From before the Gacaca courts were established, we had several sessions of people from different groups and from different intellectuals, politicians, religious people, ordinary people, coming together to say, how do we move forward? And it is through this sensitization, constant sensitization of people to say, look, we know we've had all these problems, we know what caused them, but we want to move from that. Can we forgive and move on? Can we compromise so that we can achieve the goals that we want to achieve? And that is why the Gacaca process and the reduced sentences, as you say, were not probably the wish of the victims. Many victims felt that those who committed crimes were getting away too softly, but they realized that it was the only way forward. It was a compromise that we all had to accept on all sides.
The generation from this genocide, is your nation safe today, and what is it like today in Rwanda?
Well, I think yesterday at the session, when they talked about Rwanda and its economic development, how it is moving forward. First, your president mentioned that Rwanda has been rated one of the safest places anywhere, not only in Africa, but in the world. And I think this is partly the efforts that have been put in place by government, but also the sensitization and the constant reminder of the evils of division, the evils of violence, and how we can move forward without violence, without crime, and become all better off.
Justice Cochran, how are you going to convince, how are you going to begin this process of change where we as a nation understand that maybe sometimes you have to put aside your personal differences and all move forward? So we're talking about the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary, which all maintain their arms of independence, but keep moving in the same forward.
How are we going to do that? I think we've started doing it. We have the Chief Justice of Rwanda here telling a personal story. And I think it's a graphic story. And I think we learn from the stories that we tell to each other. And if we live in a global village, and if we believe in that concept, we have to live by learning from each other's experience. And we build a common humanity by growing with the experiences that each other shares, picking up on what works in different societies, thinking about what we want to be as a society, and focusing on what we all want, which is a peaceful future.
a peaceful future? Can we all do it? And we just heard the story from the Chief Justice of Rwanda, a nation that was ripped apart by genocide in 1994. Almost 800,000 men and women were killed in 1 week as a result, a conscious choice to promote hatred and fear, looking at an elite class and what was fueled by what many say was hate media. And today, the nation is rated as one of the most peaceful and safest. And they are still in the healing process, and they came up with a court system that embraced the concept of healing and mediation. And if they can do it, I guess we can wonder. We can do it.
It was actually 3 months, not 1 week.
So we take a very short.
Even then, to kill over a million people in 3 months.
In 3 months.
That meant so many people per day.
It was, yeah. And I think you all, this story of Rwanda, knowing what started off in 1994 when the president's plane was shot down and continued throughout that year, and the international community simply looked on as the hate crimes continued. And today they no longer see ethnic divisions, and maybe one day we'll get to that as well. We take a short break. When we come back, we'll have more for you. Stay with us.
We go get fixed with materials from Radical Trading.
Come, let me show you.
The interior of your car, real Porsche, man.
Radical Trading, they have material for vehicle too. Them have everything, man. Furniture material, car covering, waterproofing for your boat. It go make everything look new.
Well, I fixing my furniture and my whole house too. Help me put the furniture back inside now.
Me and my big mode. I want a Radica anything to cover mouth.
Radica Trading, Port of Spain, Chaguanas, and San Fernando.
Need to fix your plumbing, shower, or bathroom? Yes, we have that too. Pipes, shower fittings, toilets, the widest range of Makita, Stanley, and all other hardware supplies at competitive prices. Visit our website or come in today at 185 Union Road, Marabella. Southern Wholesale Stores Limited. More than just a hardware.
Are you looking for an innovative way to control and monitor your glucose levels? Join the hundreds of people who have switched to the Code-Free blood glucose monitoring system. Code-Free makes it easy to analyze before and after meal glucose results. It has no coding, making it simple to use. 500 test memory with date and time, a 5-second fast test time with only a small blood sample volume needed. And don't even worry about the strips. Code-Free strips are among the most affordable and advanced on the market.
Try Code-Free today by trading in your old glucose machines and get 50% off every Code-Free machine. Available at Penny Wise in all leading pharmacies.
Is death to the flies, death to the roaches, death to the mosquitoes, death to the spider, death to the ants, death to flea on your clothes, death to the beaver and maribonta, death to trailing dread, death to the sandfly, death to campania, death to bugs in your bed. Now is the time to clean up the mess. Is death to all insect pests.
Death is now available in 3 formulations: citronella, lemon, and original.
Death kill them dead!
Dig into the deliciously sophisticated taste of Wendy's with our new smoked Gouda chicken, layered with flavors of caramelized onion sauce and Dijon aioli, all atop a buttery brioche bun. It's time to bring your taste buds to attention with our new smoked Gouda on brioche. Something so Gouda is only around for a limited time. So try one today. Wendy's, now that's better. Available at all locations nationwide.
Welcome back, Trinidad and Tobago. I'm here with Ramsey. Joining us on set now, Hazel Brown. We're talking about not only the week of activism, because she's in her orange this morning, but safety tips. We have a book that's been
launched. Safety pins.
Safety pins. What is it about?
Safety pin is a mobile app that is free, that is available
to help people and communities to map the safety of the audit, the safety of their areas, so that they can work with the police in terms of making the spaces safe. And this afternoon, we'll do a workshop on the promenade about how the app works, and then we'll actually do a pilot safety audit of 4 blocks in downtown Port of Spain. If you're interested, people can come and join us.
Now, let's talk about the book, and the safety. It's safety tips that you're just offering?
The book is about women in local government.
Right, and then we're also having an event this evening. So let's not confuse the two things. Okay. Right. Okay.
Today is the 25th of November. It is Orange Day.
Right.
We start the 16 days of activism that they were talking about this morning on the promenade. But the book is a different
And we're talking about
story.
Women in local government.
Women in local
and
government.
And looking at the contributions. At
yes.
They made. Okay. So when is the book being launched, or is it available?
The book is being launched tomorrow in Arima. It's part of an event that is being put on by the Arima City Corporation, I think that's what they call themselves.
Yes.
In support of action to stop violence against women in Arima.
Mm-hmm.
It's being organized by the women counselors themselves. And this is the kind of work that we expect women counselors to do. And that is why we thought that was a good opportunity to launch this book. I've been working on this book for at least 8 years. It records all of the women who've contested local government in Trinidad and Tobago from 1946 to 2013. One of the reasons why I started doing this is because when we were doing work with getting more women into local government, it turned out nobody knew about the women who were there before,
right.
Who had paved the way and did a fantastic job in making that space available for women. There are more than 500 women who have contested local government elections in Trinidad and Tobago. Today in Trinidad, we have the highest percentage of women in local government. There are 55 of them. That's 29% of the seats in local government are held by women. So we thought it was appropriate for us to launch the book, which shows how local government and women have developed from 1946, when women first voted, and how the results have developed by region. Because now you know, since 1999, there have been 14 local government regions. Some regions have done much better than others. For example, we've never had a mayor in Port of Spain. Remember, we talked about
that.
But in Arima and San Fernando, they've grown accustomed to having women. So there are different cultures regarding women that exist in the different councils. And the book demonstrates for each year, for each election that was held, what were the results, which parties did better than others, and maybe even some of the understanding of why some parties put more women candidates forward than others, why some parties are more successful.
Why do you think some parties put more women forward?
Well, it's a complex thing. It is that in most parties, the local government politics is less hotly contested than the national level politics. The politics at the local level is more what women are accustomed to and have grown to do. And like I said, the book demonstrates that it's not something that they've just started doing. This is how women in the parliament is a relatively new phenomenon. Women have been doing this in local government since 1946, and there's not been sufficient recognition of the contribution that women have made in local government, and that is what the book is trying to do. And that hopefully it will encourage many more women to become available and to run and be successful, because one of the things the book shows is a lot of women run, but they've not always been as successful as they might have been. And that was one of the reasons why, for example, we did the training sessions, which made women better prepared for taking part in local government.
Looking at taking part in local government. Now, your closing comments, Hazel, what do you want a woman in Trinidad and Tobago to know? Do you think that they feel more comfortable today running for positions of power?
Yes, they do. And like I said, this book is to give them the history. If you don't know where you came from, you wouldn't know where you want to go.
Mm-hmm.
And so far as I'm concerned, I think it's a very important contribution to the information about politics in Trinidad and Tobago, especially at the local government level. The book we will distribute the booklet to all the women who have ever run. Once you show up in Arima this evening, you will get a copy of the book. Otherwise, it will go on sale in the bookstores.
So definitely go out, get a copy of the book, and remember, we're kicking off the 16 days of activism, and today is the International Day Against Violence.
We are on the promenade for the whole day today.
And Hazel and her entire crew is on the promenade today. We take a very short break. And don't forget to wear orange. My producer is reminding me. She did remind me to wear orange today, but you know, when you get up at 3 in the morning, it's kind of crazy to coordinate sometimes.
And this is my gift to you.
Oh, thank you.
This is our 2015 diary. On the theme of our children, our responsibility. We think it's time that people understand more about the care and development of children, and all that information is in there.
Care and development of children. We take a very short break. We'll come back and have more for you. Stay with us.
Par Excellence is the number one housewife's choice in Trinidad and Tobago and is now introducing a new range of products. Jasmine rice, pet rice, basmati rice, soybean oil, and much more. Available at leading supermarkets nationwide.
For 20 years, Value Optical has cared for your eyes. And we want to celebrate the moment with you. Get 25% off your eyeglasses as our annual Frame Festival makes its way to a branch near you. With the latest styles and designer brands like Nine West, Converse, D&G, and Boss. Isn't it time you made your eyes happy? Call 800-2020 to schedule an appointment today. Or see the press for details. Value Optical, caring for your eyes.
This holiday season, decorate your home from Brand Source. We have a wide range of exquisite bedroom sets, TV stands, wardrobes, and a lot more beautiful household accessories. So come on down to Brand Source, 121 Munro Road, Kunopia, 693-2421. Open Sunday, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Brand Source.
When The Guardian rolls off the press, something more than news travels throughout the country. Like awareness from in-depth investigations that explore every role. And insightful reporting that you can be passionate about. There's satisfaction for those who need a higher level of analysis and confidence in well-researched information that gives you the edge. Even quality time from a family of entertaining features, online or offline.
So whoever or wherever you are, trust The Guardian to deliver what matters.
Welcome back, Trinidad and Tobago. I'm Hema Ramkisoon, molding the millionaire mind and the mindset of a millionaire. Can we really do it? Denise Douglas joins us on set, and it's a seminar that they're having. Good morning. How are you?
I'm fine. Thank you.
Now, what is the millionaire mind? How do you mold a millionaire mind?
I think molding a millionaire mind first conceptualizes how we must budget, how we must plan. And I think each individual needs to understand planning in the short term, medium term, and long term. If you want to achieve your goals, it's doesn't benefit by keeping it in your mind. You actually have to start writing down your plans and charting a particular course for where you want to go.
Now, in terms of this financial planning seminar, what is the most common mistake that people make as it relates to planning their finances?
Actually having no plan at all, spending beyond your means. You actually have $100 to spend and you want to spend $300.
And what do you, in terms of the or the event itself, are we going to have workshops, seminars, and some of the key speakers that's
right.
going to be addressed?
The speaker that we will be having, his name is Nicholas Dean. Mm-hmm. He is a planning trainer and advisor. He has been in the field of advising for about 15 years. He has done work for the banks, First Citizens, CBTT, also TSTT, Digicel. He would be having seminars, and on that particular day, we'd be actually doing team building, teamwork as well in this particular seminar.
Everything is about teamwork these days.
That's right.
But it's also, it's taking place on the 29th of November, so all of the details are on the screen there. And what are you hoping people leave with? Is it going to be a practical exercise that they're going to say, well, you know, you're going to learn how to do your budget, and you're going to definitely get your finances in order maybe by next month?
Okay, I don't think it's a one-fix solution, but I think what we want people to leave with is learning, first of all, how you manage your risk. You have to understand what is your objective. We know that we have unlimited needs and we have limited resources. So people have to, first of all, learn how to manage your risk, how to deal with your debt, how to actually spend better, how to set your goals. So those are some of the key things that we want to leave with people and help people to understand.
Now, looking at the cost, the time, Let's talk a little bit about those details.
Well, actually, Anson McCall Group Employees Credit Union, which is rebranded AmTQ Credit Union Cooperative Society, we will be hosting and subsidizing a great deal of the cost. So you would see it's only $75 per person, and the first 50 persons to register will be free. A seminar like this usually might cost like $2,500 you will actually pay to attend the financial seminar. But we are actually subsidizing a whole lot of the cost. And you know, the $75 is actually for the person to see I have paid something. You know, sometimes when you spend your money, you tend to value it more. Mm-hmm. So even spending a small bit of it brings a greater value. But we are subsidizing probably like 95% of this cost.
Closing comments, Trinidad and Tobago. What do you want them to know about the event?
Well, we want them to know, first of all, that we are partnering with Venture Credit Union, and it will be held in on Coover Main Road. And Anson McCall Group Employees Credit Union. This is our first one we're having and we're hoping to have a few more of these, especially considering our current economy, low interest rates, rising prices. So we want people to bear this in mind and focus on their goals.
Focusing on your goals. Denise, thanks so much for joining us. And all of the information is on the screen. Definitely go check it out. We take a very short break. When we come back, we have a treat to end with. Keo Five Star Bonia joins us on set, and we're talking about the premiere of his new video. Stay with us.
Sleepy Hollow. It's been here waiting all along.
No! Katrina!
I bring my peace. I bring a sword.
Sleepy Hollow returns to CNC3.
Greetings, this is Tifa telling you to check out the best trigger show on TV, Just Bus Acoustic, this and every Sunday at 9 p.m. on CNC3, featuring reggae and dancehall stars like yours truly, me, your girl T.I.F.A. Tifa, Assassin, Jester Royal, Chronics, and many more. You can also catch and repeat the following Sunday at 5 p.m. right here on CNC3. So don't miss it, Just Bus Acoustic, Sundays at 9 on CNC3.
Sponsored by Macassan and Nestle Orchard Vibe.
Probably just a rubbish fire, but let's keep it in check.
You heard him. Let's move.
Can't hear you out here.
Mayday emergency! Mayday emergency! Anyone from the house is being evacuated!
Watch Chicago Fire Season 3, Wednesdays at 9:30 p.m. only on CNC3.
Something missing from your morning?
The only way to start your day is with the Morning Brew. Weekdays at 6 a.m. only on CNC3.
Break it on, party and monsters.
Well, there it is, the premiere of the video Noise, 5-star.
Good morning.
How are you?
Boy, well, you know, the season started. I have two seasons going on right now. It's Christmas season and also Carnival season coming in. It started already because Carnival short. It's like non-stop pace. I was supposed to be on the promenade with you guys on Friday, and I apologize because I was getting a relapse of the chikungunya.
Now, I mean, congratulations, 5-star, because anyone looking at that, the video's of international quality. You have big announcements for this year as well, because the video is online.
Yes, online on actually Vivo, at 5-star Kilo on Vivo. We was offered, just one day I got an email stating that, that they wanted us to join Vivo because they saw the Tamahad video. And we took the offer and, we follow up on it. And there it is, we say our next video is that we're going to premiere it on Vivo. And we did premiere it last night at 8 o'clock, about 8 p.m. last night. So it was really, really nice. I love the, the support. I'm actually working on our next video as well. But this video was extremely work, just like the work with the song itself.
Now, getting a video going and having your songs and getting your whole team, obviously this season has been crazy. And when you had phenomenal success, and I understand that you've already gone up to 800 views and counting.
Right.
You had phenomenal success last year. Do you feel the pressure this year to sustain it?
Well, yes, because, last year was, the song was one of the top 10 songs, one of the top 10 soca songs, and now this year is work. Mm-hmm. Now, my goal is not trying to get back that song this year. My goal is really getting the next song that'll be just as big as this year's song.
Did you change your team this year? Are you working with anybody new?
Who
survived?
new management, Leo. Actually started working on me this year, and he follow up. He's doing a really pretty good job. Also, I started working with Dory Productions. Mm-hmm. Dory produced the video as well. Kobayashi, I work with him this year for the next song I work with on this song, and also Nikolai. Jovan James, he one of the writers who wrote To My Heart. It's like a journey. It's like real excitement. But
what did you learn from last year, 5-star, that you kind of said, I really didn't know this about the industry? That one of your harshest lesson and your most rewarding lesson last year?
I wouldn't say harsh. I would say joy. Mm-hmm. Because, some of the things that we do, is basically we doing it because we guided to do it. So I wouldn't say, I learn from the things, the mistakes that, other artists make, and I just try to, not make the same mistakes, because we do make mistakes. But I just try to, work towards my goal.
What is the one thing you think people don't know about 5-star?
How I could put this way? I real cool, humble. some people think they can't approach me, but it's not like that. You could come up and talk to me, I real humble. And if you come up to him and talk to me, he's like, he real cool, he real humble. And that is me. It's not something I try to put on. It's like, I real normal.
And what do you think is the one thing that you kind of jarred you in the soca industry? A lot of people say it's induction by fire, that, it's sometimes you have to burn to learn. Did you have any harsh lessons last year?
Harsh lessons, boy?
And what is your most memorable moment? Something that really made you smile and still lasts with you this morning?
Soca Monarch. I, the harsh lessons, I can't put like my finger or on a harsh lesson. I just learned from the mistakes.
And what is the one thing that made you smile? The one memory that you have?
It was back at Soca Monarch semifinals. That when my dad pulled number one, and I had to perform for like about, I mean, they came out and like about 20 people. And I was on stage and I was like, I really have to sing on with 20 people. But I still went out and do it. It was fun for me. Although I was at number one, I didn't, you know, really reach the finals.
Right.
But it was actually memorable for me.
And what is the one thing that you want to let your fans know about Carnival 2015 and Five Star Akil?
Boy, we have Advent, yeah. That is the next song. It's basically telling you where we at right now and where we're going to be.
Where we at and where we're going to be. We're going to close the show now and share a little bit of this video with you again. And look out for it. It's on Vivo Noise by Five Star Akil. He's definitely not rising anymore. This man is a star and he's here to stay. Stay with us. Bye.
The Morning Brew was brought to you in part by Wendy's.
Good morning, I am Akash Samaru with your newest headlines on CNC3 and the TBC Radio Network. The attorney representing Asmon Alexander says his client is being treated badly while in police custody. Alexander, who was labeled as the country's most wanted man, was held in Malabar on Sunday. He was wanted in connection with the recent Brasso Seko murders. But his lawyer Farid Ali tells CNC3 he visited his client last evening and is not happy with what he saw and was told. He said Alexander has a cut on his right ankle in addition to a swollen wrist. Mr. Ali says Alexander complained about not receiving his prescribed medication and also not being given a bath since his capture. The attorney also says that random police officers are taking pictures of him. Mr. Ali says it is alarming that the senior officers in charge of the station are allowing this to happen. Acting Police Commissioner Stephen Williams says he has put together a strong, experienced team of officers to solve the murder of a German couple in Tobago on Saturday. He made the announcement after meeting with the THA Chief Secretary over London and THA officials yesterday. It comes as the island braces for a backlash on its main economy, tourism.
It's a matter which is receiving the highest level of policing attention. I have assigned the Assistant Commissioner with responsibility for homicide investigations in Trinidad and Tobago to lead this investigation in Tobago.
And former Prime Minister and San Fernando East MP Patrick Manning says he wants to contest the seat in the next general election. The former Prime Minister has been recovering from a stroke he suffered back in January 2012. Mr. Manning, who has been the MP for San Fernando East for the last 43 years, indicated in the past he will not be contesting the seat in the 2015 general elections as he is in the sunset of his political career. In fact, this is what Mr. Manning told cameraman Ivan Tulsi last year after he voted in the local government election.
I already said that when I finish with this term of office, I am going to ride off into the sunset.
Well, stay tuned. Another news update comes up at the top of the hour right here on CNC3 and the TBC Radio Network.
Season's greetings from CNC3.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program are not necessarily those of CNC3.
Transformation. Deliverance. Determination. Success. Spiritual SOS.
Hello, people from Trinidad and Tobago. As you see, people, they walk through a mighty hands. You know, only the mighty hands of God can make you overcome your problems. Maybe you're watching this TV program and you question yourself, when this problem will end? When these problems will finish? You can see people from all over in Trinidad walking through the open hands. You know, you need the mighty hands of God in your life. You need to see God's mighty hands in your life. Come every Monday, every Wednesday, every Friday, every Sunday. You are going to walk through the mighty hands of God. I want you to look now this testimony from people that had been see results through the channel of prayer.
Yes, my life was totally destroyed when I came into this church. I came here, battered, bruised, broken. I was addicted to cigarette smoking, drinking alcohol, gambling, messed up life. I had a really messed up life. But then I came to church through my daughter and I gave my life to Jesus Christ and he transformed my life.